Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. So how do you celebrate your accomplishments? You know, those great high moments in life that are worthy of celebrating. Do you throw a party? Is there a lot of noise, a lot of cheering? Are you a fan of a particular sports team? And when your team goes the whole way, do you get out the foam finger, you know, or the signs that says we are number one? Do you maybe gloat a little bit on social media that your team is the best and somebody else's is not? We have those ways that we enjoy celebrating, and we have moments and accomplishments in our lives, our personal lives, and also our professional lives that are worthy of such a celebration. But I think there's another side to it as well. When you think of something that you've really accomplished, you find that you've put a lot of yourself and your time and your effort into it, and when it's all over, you're exhausted. You're wondering, oh, well, now what am I going to do next? And maybe celebrating is not what you're thinking about. And I think that's why this story from the book of 1 Kings is so important to us as the people of God. I think the prophet Elijah is a wonderful example of how there are moments in our lives that we have to take time to maybe reflect and celebrate in another way. Now, this is one of the great stories of the Bible. It's rather famous. We hear it on a regular basis. We've used it in Vacation Bible School, Faith Formation. It's a story that is somewhat familiar to us. Our passage is in chapter 19, but I want to take us back to chapter 17. Elijah is a prophet of Israel. What he is most passionate about is speaking out against the worship of any gods other than the one true God. And here's what happened. During Elijah's time, there was a king. His name was Ahab. And he married a woman named Jezebel, who was a foreigner. And so when she came into the kingdom, she brought her various gods and her patterns of worship with her. She influenced Ahab, and so they began to worship a variety of gods. And so then the people of Israel began to follow suit and do the same. Elijah was outraged. God was outraged. And so God sends Elijah to the king and says this. This is chapter 17. As the Lord, the God of Israel, lives, before whom I stand, there shall neither be dew nor rain these years except by my word. Because the people have been unfaithful, there's going to be a drought. And it's going to last a long time. And it's going to really hurt them and affect them. And it really happens. Elijah makes his way to another place while this happens. For 3 years he stays away. And then God calls him back to King Ahab. They meet again together in chapter 18. And this is sort of funny, I think. Ahab says to Elijah, "Is it you, troubler of Israel?" So you're back again to cause more trouble. Elijah said, "I'm the troubler of Israel. Look at you and what you're doing. You're the one who's troubling Israel." And then this great showdown ensues between Elijah and just Elijah and the prophets of the false gods. And the story tells us that there are hundreds of them. And in the midst of this confrontation, Elijah calls out to God that God would come down. He has a sacrifice on the altar, that God would bring fire down to consume the sacrifice, and that's exactly what happens. Elijah is victorious. The false prophets are rounded up, and they're eventually killed. So what does Elijah do in this moment? Does he do the touchdown dance the kids were showing us, you know? Happy to entertain you, by the way. Does a reporter come to Elijah, put the microphone in his face and say, "Hey, Elijah, now that you defeated all the false prophets, what are you going to do?" "I'm going to Disney World." No. Elijah is so sad and is so despairing. He feels like all that he wants to do is crawl up and die. And so God gives him the strength to move him to a place of rest on Mount Horeb. And God asked Elijah to wait there and that God would come to him. And that takes us to where our reading is for today, chapter 19. Now there was a great wind, it says, so strong that it was breaking up mountains. But God wasn't in the wind. And after the wind, there was an earthquake. We are told the Lord wasn't in the earthquake. And then a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a sound of sheer silence. And in that moment of silence, Elijah recognizes the presence of God. And it's then that he gets up. He meets God, and God instructs him about what's to happen next. That there will be more leaders that will be anointed, who will be faithful, more faithful. That Elijah has more work to do, but there will be a successor as God's prophet, and his name is Elijah. And that in all things, God will be with him. God comes to Elijah in silence. And you know, in a world where there's so much noise, we think that anything that happens that's worthwhile needs a lot of noise and commotion and activity associated with it. But here in this passage, the wind passes by. An earthquake passes by, a fire passes by. You can't get more dramatic than that. But God was in the silence. And this story helps us to remember and recognize that God does not always come to us in terrifying splendor, but can also come to us in tender nearness. And so, our own God moments may not seem all that dramatic. In fact, we're called to take time in our own lives to be silent, to be still, and to listen for God. In our moments of doubt, in our moments of despair, in our defining moments, we listen for the presence of God with us and among us. And we also need to remember that God's moments are in God's time as much as we would like to have them in our own. I had a thought this week that I had not had over the years about this passage and its connection with the gospel reading that is appointed for this day. So two of our worship services read four lessons from Scripture. We only read one, but we're working on that. Some people would like to hear more Scripture at this service. But the gospel reading appointed for today is the story of Jesus walking on the water from Matthew chapter 14. And you know, it's a story, and it may be familiar to many of you. I'll summarize it a little bit for us, but there's a lot of movement and drama in that, and I think that there's an insight there that sort of gets missed as a result. This story takes place right after Jesus feeds the 5,000 men along with the women and children. Pastor Ben preached on that so faithfully last weekend. Now, this is undoubtedly one of Jesus' greatest and most remarkable miracles that happened in front of so many people. What does Jesus do? Does he celebrate? Does he gloat? Does he? No. We are told that he goes off by himself to pray. And what he tells his friends, his disciples to do, is to go ahead and take the boat over to the other side of the lake. Now, it's a common theme in the stories of Jesus that when Jesus needs time to go off and pray, the disciples just can't seem to get along. They can't handle it because a storm comes up. The waters become rough. The disciples become afraid. So Jesus moves out of his time of prayer and solitude and makes his way to the boat by walking on the water. Peter thinks this is pretty great, so he jumps out of the boat. He wants to walk on the water, and he doesn't have enough faith, and so he starts to sink, and then Jesus brings him to safety. And so here's what I want us to think about with this text. Then they both make their way into the boat, and the sea is calm. And for the first time in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 14 out of 28 chapters, we are told that the disciples worship him. In that moment of stillness and calm, they realize and they recognize that Jesus is their Savior and their Lord. And that is a message for us today as well, that God's creative and God's redeeming word sometimes comes to us without a lot of fanfare, comes to us in the silent moments of our lives. God's presence in God's word comes to us, for example, as companionship in the silence of loneliness. God's presence comes to us in a word of forgiveness in the silence of alienation that we sometimes feel with one another. God's word comes to us in our times of despair, the silence of despair leading to the voice of hope in God's presence in our lives and in our world. In our relationship with God and with one another, may we take that time to be still, to know that God is God, and to listen for the still, small voice of God coming to us in many remarkable and beautiful ways. Will you pray with me? Dear God, as you embrace us as your people and as your children, forgive our noisy ways. Reclothe us in a quieter mind and a purer life for service of you and one another. Through Jesus Christ, who rose in silence, so that we will live forever with you. Amen.